Evidentemente funciona.
Sí, okay. Hello. Hi, welcome everybody. Good afternoon. So, welcome to this academic roundtable on gender and the post-human in science fiction, in which we will be discussing how the views on post-humanity affect the representations of both femininity and masculinity in sci-fi. In order to do so, let me please briefly introduce the participants of this roundtable. Mariano Martín Rodríguez is a translator, not only at the European Commission in Brussels, but also of many literary genres, including obviously sci-fi, in which he has also published extensively. He's co-editor of the online journal Elite. Josis Warwick is a doctoral student at the Autonomous University of Barcelona, and her dissertation deals with the monstrous masculine in science fiction, from science fiction film from the 80s to the present day, a fascinating subject which will give us very interesting insights to our discussion. And Juan Carlos Martín, an associate professor of Spanish and Peninsular Literature at Stonehill College, Massachusetts, as the rest of us, very interested in the post-human, in his case particularly in Spanish literature and film. Welcome, everybody. Thank you. And I think the best thing to do would be to start off by setting the theoretical basis of this debate to know what we're talking about, because the term post-human, post-humanism, etc. Well, there are many definitions. I don't know if any of you would like to.
Good evening, buenas tardes, buona tarda. We thought that we could start by giving some ideas about what posthumanism is or the posthuman, and maybe that would help us frame our discussion better. So I'll just read a couple of ideas that I put together, and then we'll go from there. It is not possible to offer a comprehensive definition of the posthuman instead of a definition. Some theories prefer to speak of posthuman existence. Mutants, aliens, monsters, and cyborgs as forms of posthuman existence. For many, posthumanism refers to the fact that our traditional view of what constitutes a human being is now undergoing a profound transformation. Posthumanism challenges the notions according to which Western society has defined what is normatively human. For some, posthumanism marks the end of a period of social development known as humanism. In fact, posthumanism is seen by some critics as an attempt to understand and deconstruct humanism from within. However, for some, posthumanism does not seek to surpass the human, or discard it, for that matter. A common view of posthumanism refers to the general convergence of biology and technology to the point where they are increasingly becoming indistinguishable. And this is probably one of the most common ideas when we think of posthumanism. Others see posthumanism as a fracture of binary limits or boundaries between the organic and the artificial. For example, when we think about reproductive technologies, cloning, gene therapy, and so forth. Some associate posthumanism and the posthuman as organic disembodiment, and this is another important aspect that we need to talk about, since the films that we are going to discuss deal with this idea of embodiment and disembodiment. For some, and this is the part that also helps our discussion, the posthuman is a site of ambiguity, a transitional space. So it's hard to define, because it challenges that dual logic or binary dualisms. And of course, when we think about the posthuman, we talk about the cyborg, and there's many definitions about, or the ideas of the cyborg. We want to think about, for example, Donna Haraway and the cyborg as a metaphor, and from there we can talk about different scenarios regarding that. So that is some of the ideas that we want to put together, and now we're going to try to use those ideas to see how posthumanism perceives gender and gender inequality or the construction of gender in these films or some of the novels that you have read, for sure. So we'll go from there.
Yes, do you think, for instance, that science fiction as a genre helps disseminate this concept of the post-human? Does it sort of do the opposite, confuse people, or does it not use it at all? Is it just an academic term, or?
Okay, I'm not really a specialist in post-humanism or even gender studies. My perspective is basically one coming from science fiction studies in a very traditional way. But if there is something I learned when studying even old science fiction, is that science fiction is everything about estranging our view of humanity. Even very early science fiction, the first ideas and the first novels of fictions with robots are very early. They already happened in the 19th century, long before computers, long before cyborgs. And from even then, in the time of Villiers de l'Isle d'Adam, Le Futur, The Future Eve, that's a classic translated also into English, there is already conception of gender and of humanity that is not the traditional one. And when reading this novel from the 19th century, I got the impression that the author, the writer, Villiers de l'Isle d'Adam, wasn't very happy with the ideas of his time. And by inventing a robot, a female robot, he was trying to propose a new kind of relationship between the genders and between the male and female gender. So I think there is a very strong relationship between science fiction as a prospective or speculative vision on the future of the future and post-humanism as such. On the other hand, I think this post-humanist view of humanity, I think that there is also a relationship with gender and also with sexual orientation. This morning I was taking part in a panel on queer science fiction, and I think there are quite many points in common, but I don't want to elaborate now because I'm talking too much. I talk too much and there are other participants.
Well, thank you very much for talking. So if we think of that post-humanity and the way it has been represented in narrative traditionally, obviously we are admitting that it has been a major theme in science fiction, even if it hasn't been coined as such to very recently. What do you think have traditionally been the representations, the traditional representations of masculinities and femininities in both films and literature?
Let's start with masculinities. Okay. I think when many people think of science fiction film and masculinities in science fiction film, they think of the hero first, which is especially the comic book heroes. When there's no, maybe not strictly science fiction, but this is the first place that people go to think about when they think of masculinity, strong, aggressive, very, what I call a traditional Hollywood masculinity, where the man is always the hero and is aggressive and strong. But also, I think always in science fiction, there has been an undercurrent, or even the same, it has the same status, is that the man as a monster. And for example, well, you can take any film. Well, I would suggest something like RoboCop, where you have a cyborg. And, well, let's call him an anti-hero, because for some of the film, he is a monster. And some of the film, he is a hero. In this way, the masculinity is questioned, is brought into question. Is beginning, he maybe does not have the most successful masculinity. After all, he is killed. You know, his aggression fails. And after, he has a period where he has lost complete control of his body. So he can't even call him a human or masculine human, because we understand that to be a human and to be a man, you must have a mind that you can think. And he does not have this. But then when he comes back, he becomes the hero, but a broken hero, because his body is broken. So I think, to sum up, that it's masculinity is represented in different ways when we think about the mind and the body. The body is very important. The masculine body, almost always we think of it as strong and powerful, this traditional phallic image. But in science fiction, this can be questioned. This can be questioned and undermined with visions of a broken body or a changed body or a threatened body. And then the mind as a privileged space where we keep our gender, where this is our true being, whether this is right or not. In science fiction, it's represented as our true identity of masculinity or femininity.
I think this is very interesting. Thank you, Josie, because in the case of femininities, traditionally, yes, it would only deal with the body mainly, and not in every fiction, of course, but mainly we're talking about mainstream science fiction. And it's interesting how even I have the Encyclopedia of Science Fiction by Peter Nichols, and I have that book. This is from 1979, my edition, I think. And if you look at the entry for women and women roles in science fiction, you get these stereotype models that he already at that time acknowledged as, you know, very stereotype, and would basically be talking about the timorous virgin or the Amazon queen. Those would be the two main characters. He also mentioned the tomboyish kid sister or the frustrated spinster scientist. But in any case, they were very dichotomized characters and always very embodied in the sense that their narrative role was played through their bodies. Secondary characters always never leading the action and never survived. And it was either, as I said, this sort of angel in the house, tamed figure, or a dangerous doll, as the ones we would see in Blade Runner or something like that. And I think this has changed a little bit in recent years. We will talk about this later. I don't know if you want to say something about the case of literature.
Yes, I wanted to, since you were mentioning gender inequalities and how we discussed prior to sitting here, we were talking about, we met for 10 minutes and we thought, okay, how are we going to frame this discussion? And we talked about some of the films, and we were thinking about Ex Machina, and we were thinking, well, how does that fiction, that science fiction, portray gender inequalities? Have we really transcended the representations of gender in those movies, and how does the female character, in the end, how is she able to get free from those constraints set by gender, and how she uses, particularly she uses those same gender conventions to break through. She uses we know that the character learns through internet and through interaction with a human, and the whole idea of the Turing test, which is very interesting in the movie, and how the machine is able to learn, but at the same time able to really transcend not just her own artificiality, but her own humanity in a sense. And how she's able to use those through trickery, of course, and deceit, she's able to break through and escape. So it has the conventions of gender are there, but at the same time, she uses those same conventions to break free.
Absolutely, I think.
Well, I don't know if I agree with your vision of this particular movie. When I saw it in Brussels in the Festival of Fantastic Film from Brussels, I got the impression that it was like a wet dream of a teenager, because this particular cyborg looked like a very hot chick. And
punching her way through, I remember you saying.
It reminded me this pulp female model of the Virago, like in many, especially comics, you see females very feminine, bodily very feminine. And they must be robots, but they're still very highly sexualized objects for the masculine gaze. So I don't think this particular movie is very innovating from the point of view of gender or the point of view of post-humanity. I think classic movies like Metropolis by Fritz Lang will address a robot woman that is an actual agent. You remember Metropolis? I think everybody has watched this movie. It's a very clear case of a cyborg, because in the inner body, the inner structure is robotic. It's made out of steel, but the exterior looks like Maria, like the heroine of the film. And this particular robot acts as a kind of leader for the city, a evil leader. But she's a leader. She's not led.
Yes, but that's precisely. Sorry to interrupt you, but Metropolis is the best example of that dichotomy. When Maria becomes a robot, she's sexualized, she's erotized. When she's a leader, she's evil. She's only good when she's tamed and when.
Well, the old science fiction tend to present women, acting women as relatively evil. I think also of
precisely. But I have a question for
always,
you, Mariano.
But not always. Not always. If you read the Future Eve, it's a very different vision of a cyborg, of a robot woman. It's the ideal woman is a robot, but I don't know if you read the novel. It's a story of a French aristocrat whose lover. Is dead, and then he asked Edison to build up a robot based on his beloved. And Edison does it, but the robot that has no soul. It's not the ideal. Only there is a kind of very spiritist or something like that, and the soul of the beloved inhabits the robots, and then it becomes. The robot becomes the ideal woman, even better than the bodily one. So I don't know, how do you interpret this novel that was written in the 19th century? It's already postmodern, it's already post-gender, post-human. I don't know. As a science fiction historian, I got the impression that many things that we believe that are new existed already a long time ago.
Well, I don't fully agree with you, but I'm going to come back to Ex Machina and just ask you what your opinion is of the ending. Do you remember the end?
I don't really remember because I didn't like the movie at all.
You didn't see the end, maybe.
I saw the end, but I forgot.
Okay,
I remember.
Right.
I
would you like to answer that?
I think
it's an interesting question.
I would like to add with regards to... escaping gender or breaking boundaries. The end of the film, I think for me, she's in a trap. She's trapped inside. She has to put on the clothes of a woman and go into the world and act the role of the woman. And I think, although some people may see it as freedom from, of course, freedom from that house, but she's going into another kind of prison, a prison where she has to act a role for the rest of her days as a woman.
I like to ask what people think about the way she escapes, because in a way she kills the man who helped her. Right? So and a lot of people identify with her, and other people don't. Most people don't, because they see a moral, a philosophical question in her, and that's interesting because obviously you're assigning the machine. The capacity to, or the responsibility of having morality.
It's interesting when we think of post-humanity, we, and many of the theorists talk about how post-humanity induces this terror and pleasure. And I think these movies are actually bringing up that same idea, that the post-human creates this idea of terror. And what is the terror? It's seeing her escaping at the end, fooling the human, and being able to really to transcend her artificiality. What causes the fear? Or is it because the fact that a cyborg has been able to really fool humans, and therefore is going to now go into the world? I know she's dressed up, and I keep saying that she uses the conventions of gender, female gender, to really exploit her goals, which is to really get free, and from there we don't know because we already lost it. She's gone.
Yes,
I was thinking, are we afraid of the cyborg or the woman? Uh-huh. Are we afraid of the cyborg escaping, or are we afraid of the woman overpowering the men and escaping?
I think it's a combination of the two, and what's scary really is that she is human in a way, and at the same time she's not human to our human standards, from a very
also evil robot woman.
But one of the things that I think we need to remember is that the whole idea of our panel was to really see how posthumanism tries to view the gender question in science fiction. And by discussing this the topic specifically, what we are doing is really reaffirming that it's not a posthuman view, because we keep talking about dual logic. So in a way, it's not really transcending that construction of gender in this particular film.
Right, this was going to be, and it's one of my questions precisely, do you think science fiction portrays this post-gender idea that is sort of one of the milestones in post-human theory?
I think Mariano can talk about Consecuencias Naturales. We had two novels that we thought would be, and I think even though Consecuencias Naturales is one of the few examples for me that really sees and gives a good picture of post-humanity transcending gender. And I don't know if you can talk about that.
Yes, well, I'm not sure that people not who are not familiar with Spanish science fiction knows this novel. The author is Elia Barceló. And this novel is called Consecuencias Naturales, Natural Consequences. It's a funny space opera with a first contact with a dying species on another planet. And what happens is that the result of first contact is one of the most macho members of the Terran crew becomes
pregnant.
And the way that the guy who's especially binary, very masculine, in the very traditional patriarchal way, doesn't accept the fact that he's going to give birth. And actually, at the end, he abandons his child, who's rare by the people from the other planet. But the good consequence is, thanks to the child, the declining civilization is going to be reborn. Well, in this particular novel, they are not cyborgs. They are really humans and aliens. And what I think is very interesting is the way how gender is overcome by inversion of the natural way of giving birth. I think this is a good example of how science fiction is strange. Because I don't think there are many cases where a man becomes pregnant in fiction in general, and where this fact is taken seriously.
I'll just add a couple of things to the idea. The idea is that these aliens don't have gender. They look the same. They have the same sexual organs, but they are not. They haven't limited their sex or gender. It's always unclear. So by creating this uncertainty, we go back to the idea of the posthuman, the idea of really creating that space where you cannot limit issues of gender or sex. So the whole novel discusses this this point, and it does it in a really interesting way, because it makes us as readers really realize that we, in order to transcend gender, we have to really get used to not thinking about biological sex constantly and so forth. So I think it's a great novel.
Yeah, I would just like to say that it's obviously a narrative device that science fiction has to use, but in terms of the both human, what we constantly see, and this hasn't changed, and I guess it's only natural, is that the theme of identity, of gender, deals exclusively with sex, either for pleasure or for reproduction. And this is something, I think, interesting. Sorry, Josie, I was going to say something. Oh.
Yes, we have to admit that sex is, in a way, immutable, and gender can, but this is the whole point of the novel. The whole point of the novel is that they discard the whole point of sex in a way that is never really clear or determined. So by taking away that idea from the dichotomy, then it's easier to address issues of gender, because sex is not limiting the discussion, and it's always sex is really forcing us to create cultural, social elaborations of sexual difference.
Can add something about film, if you like, on the same subject. I don't know if you realized, when I imagine a lot of people have seen District 9, that the aliens in District 9 have no sex either, no biological sex, but they're all portrayed as masculine, and they're all given male names, Christopher Johnson, and then they always talk about Christopher's son, which I think is very interesting. Although we can sort of almost imagine a sexless creature, not a human in this case, we can't seem to get past the fact that they must have one binary gender. They have to be something. They're all portrayed as masculine. And I wonder why.
Yes,
because it's Hollywood.
Yes, why should you gender cyborgs in the first place, or robots sometimes, right? Aliens are different. But
this is particularly interesting to Ex Machina, because according to the filmmaker, he says that when he created the character, he never gave her gender or sexual. He did, but his idea was to create this cyborg that was not sexed or it had no. But in the end, we see that the conventions of gender and come back. So it's contradictory.
It's much more convenient. I think Her is also an interesting title in these regards. We admit that those dichotomies are still valid, and that probably science fiction hasn't been able yet to overcome certain stereotypes. It has, in a way, but I'm interested in the narrative construction of the characters, and in that sense, I have to say that I have noticed the shift in the female characters, in the artificially created female characters, because in the case of the human characters in science fiction, I'm talking about film mainly, obviously my heroines were always Sarah Connor and Ellen Ripley. Ellen Ripley is the character for me. But for many years, I couldn't see a strong female character that was artificially created, or that had been through a process as Robocop. And I think in the case, if you take Ex Machina, whatever the connotations of the way she's sexualized are, the point for me is that you have a leading character that manages to survive and that overcomes everything. And the narrative is centered on her. Same thing with Her. we don't see her, but she is the main character, and she transcends. And in fact, you know, Her is Samantha is.
No, I was going to say that I see that there's a really nice parallel between Ex Machina and Her, because as you were saying, the dichotomies are there, but in the end, I think the same as Her, she has this relationship with Theodore, the guy, etc. But in the end, she says, sorry, I have other lovers and I have other people to talk to, and in fact, I'm leaving this
right
medium. So in the end, they both, I think, managed to escape. So in a way, They use the conventions of gender to get to where they want to go, but in the end, they are clever. They leave us hanging there.
Obviously, they use, I mean, with Scarlett Johansson's voice, and it's very, very gender biased. But my point is that up until now, we didn't have main female characters that were artificially created characters, and these were only, say, the replicants in Blade Runner, or Maria Robot is killed, is burned like a witch, or the other end of the spectrum, the stepford wives, or the sort of robots that are the angel in the house, the artificial angel in the house.
We're touching on something very important, which is the importance of balancing narrative with the image and representation. I think you're right that you must consider both things always. And I see a difference between the image and the representation of the male characters I study and their narrative arc. And I see the same thing as you do, that there's been a change in the narratives of these films, the narrative arcs of the male characters. From, as I explained before, the heroes and monsters, that a man can now, his body can be undermined or threatened, and he can be a monster and later a hero, or the opposite. Now before, the man was hero, and or good or bad, and now there's a lot more gray area, and I think a lot more interesting
narratives. Yes, I think that's very important. There's more grays.
I'm just sitting and I'm thinking that... That in both cases, we talked about embodiment in the case of Ava from Ex Machina, and in the case of her, which she obviously, you know, is the operating system, but how she gets this proxy lady to come and visit Theodore, the idea of acquiring a body. So the body is still a very much...
The identity is so strong. She chooses
strong.
A name.
Yeah, exactly. She feels like without the body, she's nothing. But then in the end, she realizes that embodied man, which is a big thing in the posthuman, for some theorists, it doesn't really matter. It's not necessary for some of the theorists that posthumanism is disembodiment.
I would say it's embodiment is very important. In the post-human. Yeah.
You would say embodiment is very important. Would you like to elaborate a little bit?
I think what we see is, certainly in film, an emphasis on the body and the material, increasingly. And you can take any example, District 9, for example, again. It's all about the body. And the body, how it is transformed, changed, mutated. And the post-human aspect comes, as you said a little bit before, about fusing with technology and this changing the body. But then what's different is that a lot of the time, the mind and the body remain separate. So it is difficult. In the end, they end up reinstating the same things about the mind and the body. But I think although they try to destabilize the gender through the body, they forget about that the mind is not isolated from the body. They must be, they're always in conversation with each other. It's important to remember.
Yeah, Catherine Hales makes a point of this very frequently when talking about the issue of disembodiment in the post-human.
Actually, if we're discussing films, it's very difficult to renounce the body. Actually, Hair is kind of exceptional because cinema is about viewing spectators, people watching movies need a body to identify themselves with. I think literature is much freer to explore new venues regarding gender and posthumanism, gender and cyborgs, gender and disembodiment, intelligence without the body, that existed already in the 19th century as well. And discussing movies is difficult to find a good movie that doesn't use the body in a genderized or sexualized way, because most of the audiences nowadays still need that. They still need sex. Even in Her, there is a scene where there is real sex in the movie.
But you don't see anything.
Well, You see two bodies. You see the main character and the female that embodies her in a particular moment. It's true that she leaves later, but still, there is still a show. So I think even independent movies tend to be very traditional in this way. I don't think, usually science fiction movies come like 30 years after literature. For instance, you see Star Wars, the subject, the topic, and the way of narrating it corresponds to the science fiction of the 30s, more or less. So I very much hope that these kind of concerns are going to be addressed in a proper way by cinema, even by Hollywood cinema, maybe in 2050.
If I may go back really quick to what Josh was saying, the connection between the body and the mind, and it's funny how it is portrayed in her, because she feels like without the body, at first, she is not a fully human, a fully woman, and then she hires that proxy to go and meet with him so they can really have a real sexual encounter, but there is a disconnection there because there's never between her body of this other lady and her mind, there's never a connection. So that is being really explicit in that sense.
Well, I'm glad you commented on that, Mariano, because my last question was going to be if you think the representations of femininities and masculinities differ from literature to cinema. I think we have just about 10 minutes for some questions, if anybody would like to ask anything. Because I don't know if anybody wants to comment or...
Please don't be shy. You're not. Right. Wrong. Commentary. There's someone who wants to comment and add.
Please.
Please stand up and scream.
First of all, thanks. It was very interesting. But I noticed that you're mostly discussing gender within the male-female binary. And I acknowledge there aren't that many narratives portraying non-binary characters. But posthumanism seems like the right field to explore this. Do you have anything to say on this topic? Do you know any works that tackle this issue?
We touched on this, didn't we? That we think that there are... It's very difficult to find non-binary characters in science fiction, certainly in cinema. I would struggle.
Yeah, and as a queer
mainstream
person...
cinema.
Working on, also on queer science fiction, I rarely find a connection... I think even cyborg or posthumanist is still very, very heterosexual. Still, not only in cinema, also in literature, it's like my sexual orientation minorities are not taken into account. So I also believe, as you do, that cyborgs and so on would be very nice, would be very good for non-binary sex or gender orientation or something, but. I don't think it's been exploited enough.
I thought of one. Yeah? In the culture series, Ian and Banks' culture series, the characters can change from one gender to another, well, one sex to another, actually. The gender, well, they have all sorts. They can augment their bodies in any way. Anyway. And so often, someone who is perhaps born a man will change to a woman to have a baby. And then change back, or they won't change back. Someone could change forever from a man to a woman, or the other way. And of course, there's an in-between period. It's not a sudden change, but a slow process of change, where they control with their minds. Yes.
Before I go back to your question, I think that it if I understood your question, you're thinking how can we conflate posthumanism and gender, because it's very difficult, as you pointed out. Because when we think of the posthuman, we have to go beyond gender inequality. We have to go be, we have to envision a society that has transcended gender. So in the examples that we see in fiction, in film, it's very hard to redraw those conventions because they are always present. They are always there. There's always going to be a, for example, we were talking about the films, and according to the Bechdel test, which is biased in film, where women are portrayed, where there's a gender inequality, in reality, there's no two women talking about a topic that is not men in any of the movies we have discussed. So by definition, those movies are biased in gender because they never really portray characters that can go beyond the gender conventions typically very patriarchal, very obviously biased.
I wanted to ask two questions. One, to Mariano, what do you think about a story like Deirdre, I believe it is, Deirdre de Lola Robles? There's a woman who asks for a, or has an android companion created, and she chooses how to make her, and she chooses her gender as female because she's lesbian, but then I think ultimately Deirdre wanders off, you know, becomes autonomous and walks away. And then the other one is, I wanted you to talk about The Thing, if you could just say anything at all about men in The Thing.
I can. Men in The Thing.
Thing.
The movie The Thing.
Let me to do that now. Okay. Yeah. I've only seen the old one. Yeah. I've not seen the new one. Yeah. Okay. Men in The Thing. Yeah, it's interesting. Well, a lot of things have been said about The Thing related to gender and not. A lot has been said about an allegory for AIDS. I don't know if you've heard. Yeah. So I did think about using it for a while because, yes, the men are vulnerable. They come under attack. But ultimately, they come out on top. The same as ever. I don't know. That's why I didn't use it. Yeah, the ending is nice, I suppose.
Well, in this case, I haven't read this particular piece by my friend Lola Robles. I hope she's there. But my impression is that still, we're having, as writers and as readers, many difficulties to separate gender from sex. And this is why, even when we fantasize about cyborgs and we fantasize about a future post-gender society, we don't give up on sex. We still want a partner that is corresponds to our sexual orientation or our sexual preferences. And at the end, I wonder if this discussion is not very Byzantine and maybe a little bit scholastic, when if we don't take into account the fact that we are still humans, with a certain sexual drive, and our fantasy, even science fiction fantasy, is still colored by this particular sexual drive. It's true that there are many bisexuals and so on. There are novels like The Left Hand of Darkness that try to overcome this gender bias, but still, even in Le Guin's novel, when there are romantic relationships, they are still binary. Even if the person can change sex, as Virginia Woolf's Orlando could, but the relationship there is still traditional in some way. I wonder if it's, if we are not going or reaching, like Baron Munchausen did, taking the hair in order to get out from the well. We're trying to get overcome gender, and maybe we're trying very hard, but we're still trying. With, I don't know if it's even possible. So,
Can I just add something really quick about the thing?
Yeah.
Just to make you happy. That was probably the most important thing about it is that it's gore. Yeah. That it was one of the first films to really go out there and destroy a man's body in a very visceral way, which is, so yes, that's why I like the thing.
Last question.
Yes.
Hi. I was just wondering, when you were saying earlier about Future Eve, I think it was, and the robotic became an ideal woman, and that got me thinking about the Renaissance man being an ideal man. So possibly in science fiction, we should be looking towards combining these ideas into like the ideal human, and this surely can't be too difficult for us as somewhere to look first.
Yes. yeah, we don't. We probably agree with you. Nothing, not much more to add to it. Yes, it would be nice. Of course, it would. The problem with the post-human is that it's really not a choice as the transhuman. So I'm hoping that most of it will be positive, but
maybe it's still a work in progress. And
exactly.
This is the beginning of the path.
Yes, we don't really know.
I got my glasses, so maybe I'm qualifying as starting post-human.
the iBorg. Well, I think it's time. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you. Thank you for being in the roundtable. Thank you for attending, and have a good conference.
Thank you.
Thank you, Camilla.